Hey guys, it's Medicosis Perfectionals. I'm so excited today to continue talking about pulmonology or pulmonary medicine. In the previous video, we've talked about asbestosis. Today we'll talk about idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, a restrictive lung disease. The problem is in the lung, so it's intrinsic. Dry cough and SOB, which stands for shorts of breath. Because I'm a good guy, I do not curse. With that being said, now let's get started. Lung diseases are divided into obstructive and restrictive. Obstructive, I cannot get the air out. Restrictive, I cannot get the air in. Example of restrictive lung disease, including any lung disease that ends in osis, such as pneumoconiosis, asbestosis, silicosis, borreliosis, and even idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. Restrictive lung diseases are extrinsic or intrinsic. Intrinsic are parenchymal or non-parenchymal. Parenchymal include three categories: occupational, idiopathic interstitial, and others. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is an idiopathic interstitial lung disease. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a lung disease. Is it obstructive or restrictive? It is restrictive. Is it extrinsic or intrinsic? It's intrinsic. Is it alveolar or diffuse parenchymal? It's diffuse parenchymal. Does it have a known etiology or an unknown? It's called idiopathic, honey. Unknown etiology. If you have lots of fibrosis, you have problem getting the air in, but you are good at getting the air out. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is the same thing as usual interstitial pneumonia. Chronic, progressive, parenchymal fibrosing interstitial pneumonia, restrictive, with an early stage of inflammatory and a late stage of fibrosis. It's idiopathic, unknown antigen. Contrast that with hypersensitivity pneumonitis, it was a known antigen. And we've talked about hypersensitivity pneumonitis in a previous video. This could be autoimmune, and it might be related to EBV, metal dust, or wood dust, or even gastroesophageal reflux disease. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is commoner in males who smoke. Typical patient presents between 40 to 70 years of age, and the average age is 55. If you know how to calculate the mean, also known as the average, you get the total, so 40 plus 70, divided by their number, which is 2 in this case. So 40 plus 70 divided by 2, you get 55 years. I did not lie to you. What's the pathobiology of idiopathic interstitial fibrosis? We have two stages, early, which has inflammation, and then late, which has fibrosis. Let's talk about early. Unknown antigen. Repetitive exposure to the same antigen that we do not know will lead to repetitive cycles of alveolitis. Then the macrophages will secrete cytokines. The cytokines will talk to the white blood cells. Hey, because those cytokines are communication methods for the white blood cells. Neutrophils, eosinophils, and fibroblasts, leading to diffuse interstitial pulmonary fibrosis and dilation of the proximal small airways. We call this traction, which is similar to traction bronchiectasis, which we have discussed before. Alveolitis, this damage to the alveoli, type 1 pneumocytes, and the capillary will lead to leaking. Leaking will lead to fluid inside the alveoli. When you have fluid and air at the same time, you'll hear crackles. And this can lead to hyaline membrane. What do you mean by hyaline? I mean protein. I mean they will stain pink. Later you have fibrosis, increased capillary permeability, inflammation and inflammation and inflammation, fibrosis. What are the symptoms of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis? Dry cough and dyspnea. Signs, tachypnea, because if there is dyspnea, there is tachypnea. Hello. If there is fluid and air, you'll hear crackles, mid to late. Formerly known as Velcro Rawls. And Rawls is an old term that no one uses anymore, except some old cardiologists who have to get their head out of sphincter. Hello, it's the 21st century. In idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, the crackles do not disappear after coughing. I'm sorry, but you cannot cough your fibrosis. Nail clubbing in 50% of patients. Clinically, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is diagnosis of explosion. It's idiopathic. Of course, we're going to exclude everything else. You might find acute phase reactants because of the inflammation. You can also find anti-nuclear antibodies or rheumatoid factor. They are low titer or weakly positive. Contrast that with a rheumatoid arthritis in its typical presentation. You will have high titers of rheumatoid factor and or anti-CCP antibody. bronchoalveolar lavage, you'll see macrophages and neutrophils. PFT is a restrictive pattern, absolutely. What do you mean by restrictive? I mean reduction of all lung volumes and capacities. I'm restricted from filling. Low FEV1, low FVC, but normal to high FEV1 to FVC ratio. AA gradient is widened. Why? Because the problem is in the lung. DLCO is low. Why? Because the problem is in the lung. If the DLCO is very low, oh no! That's a pulmonary artery hypertension. Pressure volume loop, you'll find decreased compliance. Flow volume loop, so you have the restrictive pattern, which is shift to the right. And I've talked about flow volume loops in a previous video in this playlist. ABG and oximetry, you'll find respiratory alkalosis. Why? Because of the dyspnea. I'm breathing in like this. I'm washing out the CO2, leading to alkalosis. When you lose an acid, you have alkalosis. In alkalosis, you have high pH, low PCO2 because it's respiratory. The kidney is trying to compensate by creating a metabolic acidosis, so the HCO3 is going to be low. Does it reach full compensation? There is no such thing on earth as full compensation. It's a theoretical term, unless you treat the underlying problem. You have decreased P small AO2. Why? There is a diffusion defect. There is pulmonary fibrosis. Here is the alveolus. And here is the pulmonary artery. It's very hard to get the air here. You can do the 6-minute walk test to measure the oxygen requirement during exercise. On chest x-ray, earlier you find inflammation. Bilateral, diffuse, interstitial infiltrates could be reticular or reticulonodular. Later you have the famous honeycombing. You'll find dilated and thickened terminal respiratory bronchioles. They form cysts like this. And these cysts are surrounded by very thick wall and fibrosis. So they look like the honeycomb. Okay, this is beautiful. Except if you have fibrosis. High resolution CT scan. Early you see the ground glass appearance. Later you see the honeycombing with the famous cystic pattern. Lung biopsy is only performed if the diagnosis is not clear. It's by far the most accurate test, although we do not do it that much if the diagnosis is clear. Rule out any vasculitis, infection, or cancer. Why? Because if it is interstitial pulmonary fibrosis, we're going to give the patient immunosuppressors, such as, say, corticosteroids. But if the patient had infection, you are making it worse. So you better rule out those diseases first. When not to perform a lung biopsy? Number one, if a patient is not a candidate for treatment with immunosuppressant, because there is no point. Or if the patient is older than 70 years of age, in this case, he's probably gonna die from his heart disease or from his diabetes, not from some fibrous tissues in his lungs. He's not running a marathon at 70 years of age. Complications, if there's lung fibrosis, the right heart is trying to pump blood against this thick and sick lung. This will lead to pulmonary artery hypertension, right ventricular hypertrophy, right-sided heart failure. Eventually, this will lead to jugular venous distension, ankle edema, and liver distension. Prognosis, it's not so good. Median survival rate is only 3 to 5 years. Management, we have 2 stages. Early, which is inflammation, is treatable. But the fibrotic stage is untreatable because fibrosis is irreversible. So my dad, who lives in Egypt, has a PhD in pathology. Once upon a time, a drug sales representative came to his office and said, "Sir, I have a new drug for you. This drug can treat fibrosis." My dad told him to just turn around and count the stairs of the staircase while going down and leaving the office, because he was a scumburger. This is Egyptian hospitality right there. That's why I'm very good with these lectures, because like father, like son. How to treat early, which means before fibrosis, interstitial pulmonary fibrosis. Steroids. Do not use as monotherapy for maintenance. You can combine them with azathioprine and acetylcysteine. We use N-acetylcysteine and something else. Do you know it? Let me know in the comments. Or you can use N-acetylcysteine alone. There is a drug called pyrifenidone. It's anti-fibrotic agent. It prevents fibrosis. It does not treat fibrosis. Get your head out of your sphincter. Side effects, photosensitivity and rash. There is another drug called nintedanib, which seems like a tinib. So it's a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, tinib or danib or whatever. Side effects, liver problems, check the LFTs. Omeprazole for the GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, because many patients with interstitial pulmonary fibrosis have GERD at the same time, and we have no idea why. Those of you who listen to those online gurus with their natural juice cleansers, you need to ask for evidence. If they claim they know the link, they need to provide scientific evidence. They should not pull it off their hats. You vaccinate against a virus, give the influenza virus vaccine, and also known as the flu shot, and a bacteria, such as the pneumococcal vaccine. Lung transplant is last resort when the bleep hits the fan. How do you treat interstitial pulmonary fibrosis exacerbation? High-dose steroids. How should you treat core pulmonary symptomatically and single lung transplant last resort? If you are struggling to learn about Legionella, Mycoplasma, Pseudomonas, Rhinovirus, Staph, and Strepton E. coli, check out this website called Picmonic. They have picture mnemonic for medical students. See the link in the description below. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and smash like. Also help me by sharing. Follow me on Facebook. I have more than 100 cases there. You can get my premium videos, my cases, my post notes, my PDF notes, the slides of these videos, and every other videos. Patreon.com/medicosis. Thank you so much for watching. As always, be safe, stay happy, and study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionist, where medicine makes perfect sense.